here at the altar, you know, at the end of that gospel, Dick and I both just said, whew. Please be seated. Yes, the good news, the good news. If you don't do this, watch out. So I actually have come to love this this passage on forgiveness. I don't know if some of you might remember several Lent ago. So Lent is that season, you know, that long season before Easter. And we traditionally do some kind of gathering, some kind of adult education during that time. And we did a whole series on forgiveness. And we dealt pretty deeply into all the issues around forgiveness. You know, if somebody just does, you know, bumps into you or cuts you off on the freeway, I mean, you might get, like, you know, unhappy about it. But it's not something that you carry around with you, usually even for the rest of the day, right? I mean, it's a bump in the road. You get over it and you go on. But there are other times when it really hurts. And every time you think about it, it hurts all over again. And in fact, as time goes on, it doesn't get better. It kind of gets worse because all the ramifications of whatever was done to you, whatever betrayal or whatever it was, kind of play out. And forgiveness is not an easy thing. And it's especially not hard if you carry around, you know, this command that you need to forgive. Like, layering that injunction on top of the wound itself just kind of, it just becomes this complex sea of emotion and thought and resentment and bitterness, you know, and you know. Does anyone know what I'm talking about? I mean, we all have that experience, right? America is shaking her head no, but I think it's something that we live with. So this whole gospel, and in fact, the very center point of the Lord's Prayer, right, is forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. If you look at the Lord's Prayer kind of as a chiastic structure, that is the center point of it. It's the hinge of the whole thing. Thy will be done, thy kingdom come. Will it, thy will be done and thy kingdom comes through that lens of forgiveness, of that kind of hard lens of forgiveness. So it's, I'm not up here with any easy answers. You know, we explored in that several weeks, I think it was 5 weeks, of like, well, how do you do that? And there's wonderful, I mean, Stanford now has, it's called the Forgiveness Project. So this is not just a spiritual thing anymore. I mean, people are discovering psychologically, scientifically, as well as spiritually, forgiveness is key to our health, to physical health, as well as mental, emotional, and spiritual health. So if you're interested, you can look up the Stanford Project, or the Stanford Forgiveness Project, because there's really excellent resources there on how to walk through that path of forgiveness. But Jesus gives us a clue in this gospel also, with this little parable. So, it helps to translate a little bit of this from, you know, what did this first slave, 10,000 talents he owed? Now, first of all, who knows how he racked up that kind of debt? But he did. How much is that 10,000 talents of silver? So a talent was about, one talent was about 130 pounds of silver. Okay. That's a lot of silver. I'm not sure. I think I could lift 130 pounds, but it would be hard. He owed 10,000 of those. I didn't do the math. Somebody can do the math on that, but that's a lot of silver. That would have been about 150,000 years of labor. So Jesus is doing a traditionally Middle Eastern thing of hyperbole. I mean, that is so much debt that you couldn't possibly pay it back. Right? Even if you worked the rest of your lifetime, you could not pay that back. So, in other words, he is in debt, my friends. Really in debt. And the king wipes the slate clean, says, go your way. Go your way. You are completely released. Like, just if somebody paid off your credit card bills, right? That would feel really good. Somebody paid off your mortgage, your car payments, your whatever else you're in, like, the hot for. Somebody just wiped that slate clean. That would feel really good, wouldn't it? So this man has been completely released. Goes out on the street, somebody comes along who owes him about a day's wage. A day. Seizes him by the throat. I mean, Cynthia read this really well. Seizes him by the throat. Throws him into debtor's prison. You're going to stay in there till you can pay me back. I mean, so somewhere in this man's heart, I don't think that he'd ever really received the good news of his forgiveness. You know, if he could turn around and do that to somebody, he hadn't really released himself, right? King had released him, but I don't think he had released himself from his own judgment and shame about the debt he was in. He was still in prison, not because the king imprisoned him, but because he himself was imprisoning himself. And so when he got to somebody else who owed him, boom, projects it right out onto that other person, seizes him by the throat, throws him into prison. And of course, we heard what happens next. King hears about it and says, hey, that's not cool. You go to prison too. The truth is, when we don't forgive, when we harbor grudges, bitterness, unforgiveness, we are imprisoned. It is a prison. And so we do it to ourselves. So where's the good news in all of this? Where's the good news? You know, we could say, well, the good news is it's good to forgive. It's healing to forgive. We could say that forgiveness frees us. It heals us. This is all true. We can recognize where we've been forgiven and send that out to other people. That's good news. But I think that overall, the incredible, unbelievable, amazing good news of this story is to receive for ourselves how very, very, very much we are forgiven. More than we can ever really know. We are forgiven, sent free, free. I mean, that opens up so many possibilities for healing and peacemaking and reconciliation and joy and abundance. So I'd invite us this morning and the rest of this week and the rest of our lives, really, to dwell in this utter, amazing truth of the King's forgiveness. Wiping it clean. You don't owe.